الحمد لله الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا وحبيبنا وسندنا ومولانا محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله تعالى عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه وبارك وسلم تسليمًا كثيرًا كثيرًا أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم سابقوا إلى مغفرة من ربكم وجنة عرضها كعرض السماء والأرض أعدت للذين آمنوا بالله ورسله ذلك فضل الله يؤتيه من يشاء والله ذو الفضل العظيم صدق الله العظيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم لا فهم لنا إلا ما فهمتنا إنك أنت الجواد الكريم My dear respected brothers, respected sisters, we find ourselves in the latter part of this month of Sha'ban, the month in which our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to prepare for the month of Ramadan immensely. So we know that Nabi of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would increase his fasting. He would fast a lot in the month of Sha'ban. He would do things by which he can prepare for the month of Ramadan. Hakim al-Ummat, Mawlana Ashraf Ali Thami rahimahullahu ta'ala, he mentions a beautiful point which is so relevant to us, especially at this time where we find ourselves very close to the month of Ramadan. Just over a week, and inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant us again the opportunity of experiencing this auspicious and blessed sacred month of Ramadan. So Hakim al-Ummat rahimahullah ta'ala, he would say, تَأْخِيرِ الطَّاعَةِ مَتْلُوبْ نَهِي تَسَارُعْ اُرْ تَسَابُقْ إِلَى الْخَيْرَاتِ مَتْلُوبْ هَي My dear brothers, my dear sisters, our akabir, our pious predecessors were such that just in a few words, they would tackle major topics. تَأْخِيرِ الطَّاعَةِ مَتْلُوبْ نَهِي That to delay one's action, this is not what Sharia has encouraged us. To delay one's action, this is not what Sharia encourages. If you ponder over the teachings of the Quran Sharif, and you ponder over the teachings of our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you will never find a scenario where we are being told to delay our actions So maybe the month of Ramadan is coming. You will never find that you should delay your action till the month of Ramadan. You will never find that delay your recitation of the Quran Sharif to the month of Ramadan. We just experienced the 15th night of Sha'ban. You will never find in the Quran and the Ahadith that delay your actions to the 15th night of Sha'ban. No. The days of Hajj, the first 10 days of the Hijjah, Laylatul Qadr, the last 10 nights of the month of Ramadan. You never find where Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are encouraging us to delay our actions to specific nights or specific days. تأخیر طاعت مطلوب نہیں. یعنی کبھی آپ قرآن پر غور کریں گے, احادیث شریفہ پر غور کریں گے, تو کبھی آپ کو یہ نظر نہیں آئے گا کہ ایک مخصوص رات تک یا ایک مخصوص دن تک یا کچھ مخصوص رات اور دن تک ہم ہمارے اعمال کو موقوف رکھیں. نہیں, یہ کبھی نہیں ملے گا. تسارع اور تسابق الى الخیرات مطلوب ہے. But rather, if you look at the Quran Sharif, and if you look at the teachings of our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you will find that Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are always telling us to hasten towards good deeds. Whenever the opportunity comes, whenever the thought comes in someone's mind that let me do this good deed, he should do that good deed. He should not delay it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He mentions in the Quran Sharif, فَاسْتَبِقُوا الْخَيْرَاتِ. Hasten in doing good deeds. Be speedy in doing good deeds. Hurry in doing good deeds. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, يُسَارِعُونَ فِي الْخَيْرَاتِ. That they, the Muslims, the mu'mineen are such that they hasten with one another, they compete with one another in doing good deeds. And ulama have even written that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will place a thought, a good thought, in a person's mind and heart that do this good deed. And this person will be negligent of it. He will pay no heed towards it. Then again Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will place his thought into a person's mind and heart. But again he will be negligent of it. And then the time will come, Allah save us all, when that thought of doing good will be taken away from him. This person will now be deprived of tawfiq. This person will now be deprived of divine opportunity from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. یعنی ایسا ہوتا ہے کہ اللہ سبحانہ وتعالی کسی کے دل و دماغ میں ایک خیال ڈالتا ہے کہ چلو یہ نیکی کرو, یہ نیکی کرو, یہ نیکی کرو, تو جبکہ پہلی مرتبہ یہ خیال اللہ سبحانہ وتعالی کسی کو دل و دماغ میں ڈالتے ہیں کہ یہ نیکی کرو, پھر انسان اس کی طرف غور نہیں کرتا, انسان اس کی طرف کچھ توجہ نہیں دیتا, تو یہ ایک بار ہوا. پھر دوسری بار اللہ سبحانہ و تعالی خیال ڈالتے ہیں کسی کے دل و دماغ میں کہ چلو یہ دوسری نیکی کرو, پھر بھی اس شخص نے اس نیکی کی طرف کوئی توجہ نہیں دی. تو تیسری بار ہوتا ہے, اور اس کے بعد بھی ہوتا ہے. اور علماء فرماتے ہیں کہ ہم ڈرتے ہیں اس چیز سے کہ کبھی ایسی صورت نہ بن جائے, کبھی ایسی صورت نہ بن جائے کہ اللہ سبحانہ و تعالیٰ اس شخص کو محروم فرما دے, یعنی محروم رکھ لے. کیونکہ اللہ نے بار بار یہ توفیق عطا فرمائی کہ یہ نیکی کرو, یہ نیکی کرو, یہ نیکی کرو, لیکن اس شخص نے کسی قسم کی توجہ ہی نہیں دی, پھر یہ توفیق کا دروازہ یہ بند ہو جاتا ہے اللہ سبحانہ و تعالیٰ کی طرف سے. سو اللہ سبحانہ و تعالیٰ mentions in سورۃ الحدید, And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also mentions in Surah Ali Imran, very similar verses. In one, Allah uses the word sari'u. And in one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses the word sabi'u. Surah Ali Imran, وَسَارِعُوا إِلَى مَغْفِرَةٍ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ وَجَنَّةٍ عَرْضُهَا السَّمَاوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضُ أُعِدَّتْ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. And Surah Al-Hadid, سابقوا إلى مغفرة من ربكم وجنة عرضها كعرض السماء والأرض. سابقوا إلى مغفرة من ربكم. Look at the announcement from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is saying سابقوا إلى مغفرة من ربكم. That compete with one another. Compete with one another in hastening towards the maghfira, towards forgiveness from your Lord. وَجَنَّةٍ عَرْضُهَا كَعَرْضِ السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ. And compete with one another, hasten with one another, challenge one another. Compete with one another in what? The second thing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, وَجَنَّةٍ عَرْضُهَا كَعَرْضِ السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ. Compete with one another, hasten with one another in trying to attain the paradise. وَجَنَّةٍ عَرْضُهَا كَعَرْضِ السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ. And the width of that paradise is the width of the heavens and the earth. Now ulama mention, what does it mean by سَابِقُوا? This word سَابِقُوا, what does it mean in this verse? The ulama mentioned there are two meanings to this word سَابِقُوا in the context of this verse of Surah Al-Hadid. One is that do not delay your actions. Do not think that, chalo, today I will not recite my Quran, tomorrow I will recite Quran. No. Do not delay your actions. Rather, try and do your actions as soon as possible. And raise against inability. Fight and race against weakness. Fight and race against death. Because today you might be healthy, tomorrow you will be weak. Today you might be well, tomorrow you might be ill. Today you might be strong, tomorrow you will become weak. And it is a known fact that everyone will accept, that as you grow older, as you grow older, as time goes on, your health also deteriorates. So today what me and you can do, Allah save us all, there may be a day in our life when we will not be able to do a certain good deed because of our health. Today our hands are in perfect order. Today our legs are in perfect order. Today our eyes are in perfect order. Today our nose is in perfect order. Today our ears are in perfect order. Today our heart is in perfect order. Alhamdulillah, most of our organs and limbs are in perfect order. Whilst we are in perfect order, whilst we are in perfect health, whilst we have good well-being, we should make the most of these opportunities and do the good deeds that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to do. So we can accumulate so much for ourselves, and we can store it in the hereafter by doing good deeds in this world. This is one meaning. And the second meaning, the ulama mentioned, that compete with one another. Compete with one another. Ek dusre se musabaqat karo. Ek dusre se competition karo. Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he would advise the people. And he would say that be amongst the first ones to go to the masjid and be amongst the last ones to come out of the masjid. My dear brothers, my dear sisters, and those that may be listening in, and especially the male folk, Hazrat Ali radiallahu anhu is saying that be the first ones to come to the masjid and be the last ones to come out of the masjid. And when our masjids were open, every person should ponder over himself. How did we find our situation? We were the last ones to come into the masjid. We just about got the first salah with the imam. And as soon as the salam was given and we missed raka'at, then we were the first ones to go out of the masjid. Whereas أَحَبُّ الْبِلَادِ إِلَى اللَّهِ مَسَاجِدُهَا, that the best of places, the most beloved places in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are the masajid. سب سے محبوب جگہ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala کے یہاں وہ مساجد ہے. The most beloved places in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are the masajid. And this was our condition when it came to the masajid, the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when our masajids do open again, let us be from those people that we spend time in the masjid. We come early for salah, and after salah we stay in our places. We engage in the tilawah of the Quran Sharif. We engage in different forms of zikr. We participate in the programs that take place in the masjid. Dars-e Quran is being given in Urdu and in English. The words of Allah are being explained. Do we want our whole lives to go without understanding the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Do we want our whole lives to go without making an attempt to understand what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling me and you? And Hazrat Anas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he would say that try to be present for the first takbir of the congregational prayer. And jab ke wo namaz shuru hogi, yani abhi tak imam ne takbir tahreema nahi kahi, usse pehle aap namaz mein hazir ho jao taaki aapko takbir tahreema imam ke saath lag jaye aur mil jaye. According to the nearest meaning, according to the nearest effect, it is a hadith of our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that that person who performs 40 salah with jama'ah, with the first takbir, that person who performs 40 salah with jama'ah, continuously, and in some hadith it is mentioned with the first takbir. Now my memory does not recall, but once when he is Madinatul Munawwara and reading 40 salah, I think in Madinatul Munawwara, as far as my memory recalls, in Madinatul Munawwara, performing the 40 salah with the imam is sufficient. You don't have to even get the first takbir. In normal masajids, the fadila has come, the 40 salah with the imam in jama'ah with the first takbir. Takbiratul Ula. Then our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he guaranteed two things for a person: bara'atun minan nar, bara'atun minan nifaq. In a sense, he will become free from hypocrisy and he will be granted freedom from the fire of Jahannam. So let us all try, once the masjid is open, that 40 salah continuously we will try and be there for the first takbir in the masjid. My dear brothers, my dear sisters, if we ponder over the life of the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'een, we will find so many different scenarios. We will find on so many different occasions that the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum would love to compete with one another for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. From a dini perspective, and only to increase their value and their rank in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they would love to compete with one another. So one sahabi would look at another sahabi, and maybe he would see that in this sahabi, this particular action, mashallah, he is very punctual with this particular action. And then this sahabi would look into his own life and he would think to himself that why am I depriving myself of this particular action? That mashallah, this sahabi is so punctual and so consistent with a particular action and he is accumulating so much reward for him. And he is storing for himself so much reward in the hereafter. Why am I so deficient with this particular action? The Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum would look at one another. And they would try to compete with one another. Only to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And my dear brothers, my dear sisters, let us ponder over our condition. Let us ponder over our true reality. Have we ever thought, have we ever looked at someone? And have we ever looked at someone and we said, MashaAllah, this person is so punctual with the recitation of the Quran Sharif. Daily he recites 3 paras, for example. Have we ever thought to ourselves, why can I not be like this person? Why can I not regularly recite the Quran Sharif? My dear brothers, my dear sisters, we compete with one another in everything apart from the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When it comes to dunya, when it comes to the world, we compete with one another for everything. We see that someone has brought a new house, someone has purchased a new house, we also want a similar house. We become aware that this person, his financial status is very good. We also go out of our way and we think to ourselves that how can I also become like him from a financial perspective. So when it comes to dunya, we are always competing with one another. But when it comes to the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, why do we not compete? My dear friends, my dear brothers, my dear sisters, when we see that our friend's child, our friend's son, or someone in the locality, in our locality, their son has become a hafidh al-Quran. Hafidh al-Quran. That within that son's heart, the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have now been embedded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his heart. The entire Quran has been brought to memory. Do we ever think and do we ever envy this child? Envy meaning that do we ever think that I wish my child was like this? I wish my child had become a hafidh al-Quran. Do we ever think to ourselves? Do we ever raise the question to ourselves? Do we ever point the finger to ourselves? Do we ever say that is it maybe because I am doing something wrong? Maybe in my upbringing, maybe in my nurturing of my child, I am doing something wrong. And because of this, my child has not become hafidh al-Quran. What can be better than memorizing the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The best book on the face of this planet, the Quran Sharif. The words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The words of our Creator who has created me and you. Who has created each and everything we see on the face of this universe. What can be better than memorizing the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? A person, he becomes an alim. He understands what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying in the Quran Sharif. He understands what our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying in his Ahadith Sharifa. The best sayings of any human being who has ever set foot on the face of this earth, which have been recorded and preserved, is the sayings of our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And now this person who has become alim, who has become alim ad-deen, he now understands the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What can be better than that? But have we ever pondered over ourselves? That my child, why has he not become an alim? Have we ever thought about our hereafter when we are in our graves? That alim, that hafiz al-Quran, that alim al-Quran, he will be spreading the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So many people will be taking benefit from him, from his knowledge. And this will become a means of sadqa jariyah for his parents. So as parents, have we never thought that I want to leave my child behind in such a state that he is a hafidh al-Quran? I want to leave my children in such a state that they become ulama-i-deen, They become the flag bearers of deen. They become those who serve the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this will benefit me in my grave. This will benefit me in the hereafter. This will become a means of sadaqah jariyah for me. Have you ever thought like this? Look at the example of Hazrat Abu Bakr and Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu. It is mentioned in the Hadith Sharif that on the occasion of Ghazwa Tabuk, Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he mentions, أَمَرَنَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ يَوْمًا أَنَّ تَصَدَّقَ. That our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he ordered us one day to give sadaqah, to give in charity. فَوَافَقَ ذَلِكَ مَالًا عِنْدِي. And then Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he says in the narration that it so happened at that time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had granted me wealth. So immediately his mind went to Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala, immediately. And in the narration it is mentioned that Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he then said, Al-Yawma Asbiqu Aba Bakr in Sabaqtuhu Yawman. That if there was ever going to be a day in my life where I could surpass and exceed the great being of Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, then today is that day. Because I have wealth. Fajitu bi nisfi mali. So he mentions, I went home and I brought back half of my wealth. This is the competition of the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu majma'in. This is how they would compete with one another. فَقَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ مَا أَبْقَيْتَ لِأَهْلِكَ. So when Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he brought back half of his wealth, our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam posed the question, مَا أَبْقَيْتَ لِأَهْلِكَ. That, oh Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, what have you left behind for your family? قُلْتُ مِثْلَهُ. He said, the amount that I have brought, the amount that I have bought, the amount that I have brought, the similar amount I have left behind. Meaning I have brought half of my wealth, I have left half behind. وَأَتَى أَبُو بَكْرٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى عَنْهُ بِكُلِّ مَا عِنْدَهُ. And then Hazrat Abu Bakr رَضِيَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى عَنْهُ, he brought back everything which he had. فَقَالَ لَهُ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ مَا أَبْقَيْتَ لِأَهْلِكَ. So Nabi of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam posed the same question to Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, that what have you left behind for your family? قَالَ أَبْقَيْتُ لَهُمُ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ. So Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he mentioned that I have left behind Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Meaning he had brought everything he had. So the wealth that Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu had compared to the wealth that Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu had, the wealth of Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu was greater, was more. But the sacrifice of Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu was greater. My dear brothers, my dear sisters, this was how the Sahaba would compete. And then at that time, Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, لا أسابقك إلى شيء أبدا. That, oh Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, I will never be able to surpass you in anything. That I will never be able to surpass you in anything. So this is how the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in will compete with one another. And Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu is that individual with regards to our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, when Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu posed the question that is it absolutely necessary that one be called from one of these gates? And the background to this statement of Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu was Our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam mentioned certain people who were more punctual with a certain type of worship. So our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, فَمَنْ كَانَ مِنْ أَهْلِ الصَّلَاةِ دُعِيَ مِنْ بَابِ الصَّلَاةِ, that the one who is very punctual with salah, he will be called from Babu salah. He will be called from the door of salah. Enter Jannah from the door of salah. وَمَنْ كَانَ مِنْ أَهْلِ الصَّدَقَةِ دُعِيَ مِنْ بَابِ الصَّدَقَةِ, and that person who was punctual in giving charity, he will be called from Babu Sadaqah. That person who was punctual with fasting, وَمَنْ كَانَ مِنْ أَهْلِ الصِّيَامِ دُعِيَ مِنْ بَابِ الرَّيَّانِ, he will be called from Babu Rayyan. Meaning when he enters from that door, his thirst will be quenched. So Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu at that time said, that is it absolutely necessary that one be called from one of these gates? Or can someone be called from all of these gates? And then our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Na'am, wa arju an takuna minhum. Yes, it is possible that someone be called from all of these gates of Jannah. And I have hope that, oh Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, you will be the individual who will be called from all the eight doors of Jannah. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. It is a belief of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah that after the Anbiya alayhi salatu was salam, the best ever being to set foot on the face of this earth was the being of Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala. Let me cite another example before you, which shows how the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhu would compete with one another in hastening towards good deeds. It is mentioned in the hadith of Muslim Sharif that أن فقراء المهاجرين أتوا إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, that the poor immigrants, the poor muhajirin, those that had migrated from Makkah al-Mukarramah to Madinah al-Munawwara, they had left everything behind. Their properties, their wealth, they had left everything behind for the sake of Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. These poor immigrants, these poor muhajirun, they are coming in the company of Nabi of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And what do they say? They say, ذهب أهل الدثور بالدرجات العلا والنعيم المقيم. That O Nabi of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ahlul Duthur, that the rich, the wealthy amongst us, they have attained high ranks and everlasting bliss. And we have fallen behind. They were saying in simple words that the wealthy amongst us, they have attained everlasting bliss. They have attained high ranks. And we have been left behind. So our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, wa ma dhak? And what makes you say this? How is this possible? فَقَالُوا, and then these four immigrants radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in, they said, يُصَلُّونَ كَمَا نُصَلِّي. Imagine how closely these poor immigrants, these fuqara'ul muhajirin, must have looked at the wealthy Sahaba radiallahu anhu majma'in. Because they are giving a detailed description to our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they say, يُصَلُّونَ كَمَا نُصَلِّي, that just how we pray salah, they pray salah. وَيَصُومُونَ كَمَا نَصُومُ, and just how we fast, they fast. وَيَتَصَدَّقُونَ وَلَا نَتَصَدَّقُ, they give in charity, they give in sadqah, we cannot give in sadqah. وَيُعْتِقُونَ وَلَا نُعْتِقُ, they also free their slaves, and we cannot free our slaves. We cannot free slaves, because we are so poor that we cannot first and foremost keep slaves. So the question of freeing slaves does not exist. And we are poor, so the question of giving in charity, of giving sadqah, it does not exist. So because of these two things, because of their wealth, those wealthy Sahaba, they can give in charity And because of their wealth, the wealthy Sahaba can also free their slaves. So at this point, our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, أَفَلَا أُعَلِّمُكُمْ شَيْئًا تُدْرِكُونَ بِهِ مَنْ سَبَقَكُمْ وَتَسْبِقُونَ بِهِ مَنْ بَعْدَكُمْ. That all poor immigrants, O fuqara muhajirin, radiyallahu anhum ajma'in, shall I not teach you of something? Shall I not teach you something by which if you were to act upon, you will be able to catch those who have surpassed you? And if you act upon the same thing, you will surpass and exceed those people who come after you. وَلَا يَكُونُ أَحَدٌ أَفْضَلَ مِنْكُمْ إِلَّا مَنْ صَنَعَ مِثْلَ مَا صَنَعْتُمْ. And no one will be able to be more superior than you, but that person who carries out the same good deed that you do, which I am going to tell you about. So then Nabi of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, تسبحون وتكبرون وتحمدون دبر كل صلاة ثلاثا وثلاثين مرة. But after every salah, do the tasbih, do the takbir, and do the tahmid 33 times. So glorify Allah, say takbir, and praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala 33 times. So say subhanallah 33 times, say Allahu Akbar 33 times, and say alhamdulillah 33 times. فرجع فقراء المهاجرين إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. So these poor immigrants, after some time, they return back to Nabi of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم. And they say, سمع إخواننا أهل الأموال بما فعلنا. That the wealthy Sahaba from amongst us, they have heard with regards to what we are doing. ففعلوا مثلا. And they have also started to practice this same action of reciting tasbih, takbir, and tahmid after every salah. So at this time, Nabi of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, ذَلِكَ فَضْلُ اللَّهِ يُؤْتِيهِ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. That this is the grace of Allah, this is the bounty of Allah. And Allah gives His grace, Allah gives His bounty to whom He wills. So my dear friends, my dear brothers, my dear sisters, this was how the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in would compete with one another. And in this hadith, it is mentioned to say subhanallah 33 times, to say alhamdulillah 33 times, and to say Allahu Akbar 33 times. In other ahadith we find that our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned to say subhanallah 33 times, to say alhamdulillah 33 times, and to say Allahu Akbar 34 times. And in some hadith we find where our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he also said la ilaha illallah وحده لا شريك لا له الملك وله الحمد وهو على كل شيء قدير. And according to some narrations, لا إله إلا الله. And this was done to make the century. So 33, 33, 33, 99. And then rounded up by saying لا إله إلا الله. Or by saying لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له له الملك وله الحمد وهو على كل شيء قدير. And this would make the 100. So Allama Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentions يَنْبَغِي أَنْ يَجْمَعَ بَيْنَ الْرِوَايَتَيْنِ بِأَنْ يُكَبِّرَ أَرْبَعًا وَثَلَاثِينَ وَيَقُولُ مَعَهَا لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَحْدَهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ لَهُ الْمُلْكُ وَلَهُ الْحَمْدُ وَهُوَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٌ. Now it is better that one, he acts upon all of the narrations. And how can we act upon all of the narrations? Is by saying subhanallah 33 times, by saying alhamdulillah 33 times, by saying Allahu Akbar 34 times. So this is the century. And then saying la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika la lahul mulku wa lahul hamdu wa huwa ala kulli shay'in qadir after every salah. And by this, inshallah, you'll get more reward. And by this we will be acting upon all of the narrations as well. And ulama mentioned about this verse of Surah Al-Hadid, which our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also said towards the conclusion of this hadith which I mentioned before you. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ذَلِكَ فَضْلُ اللَّهِ يُؤْتِيهِ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. That this is the grace of Allah, and Allah gives it to whom He wills. So until now, in the previous verse of Surah Al-Hadid, or in the same verse we can say, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was saying that compete with one another, race with one another, hasten with one another towards the maghfirah and towards paradise. Towards maghfirah and towards paradise. So and now a person may think, and then Allah said, وَجَنَّةٍ عَرْضُهَا كَعَرْضِ السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ أُعِدَّتْ لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرُسُولِهِ. That is, paradise has been prepared for those who believe in Allah and for those who believe in His messengers. So until now, someone may have thought that a person can attain Jannah through his own actions. In order to remove this thought, or in order to answer this question, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then brings the next verse, ذَلِكَ فَضْلُ اللَّهِ يُؤْتِهِ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. That these good actions that a person may be doing, these good actions that a person may be doing, it is not through his own good, but it is only because he has been granted the divine opportunity by the great Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to do these good deeds, hence he is doing it. And ab tak Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ne farmaya tha ki neki karo, ek dusre se competition karo, ek dusre se compete karo, ek dusre se musabakat karo nekiya karne mein, jannat ko kamane mein, hasil karne mein. Aur fir Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ne farmaya tha ki ye jannat muttaqin ke liye, un logon ke liye paida ki gayi hai jo Allah par iman le aaye aur uske rasoolon par iman le aaye. To fir abhi sawal paida ho sakta hai kisi ke zehen mein ke aadmi khud apne aamal se jannat hasil kar sakta hai. To is sawal ke jawab mein Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ne aainda ayat mein, aane wali ayat mein farmaya, zalika fadlullah yu'tihi man yasha, ke koi shakhs khud apne aamal se jannat hasil nahi kar sakta, ye sirf Allah ki fazl se hai. Jo nekiya hum karte hain, jitni bhi nekiya karte hain, wo sirf Allah ki fazl se, Allah ki tawfeeq se hota hai. That all of the good actions we are doing, they only happen because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted us the tawfiq of doing those good actions. ذَلِكَ فَضْلُ اللَّهِ يُؤْتِيهِ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. This is why in the hadith it is mentioned, and I will conclude with this hadith. It is mentioned, وَعْلَمُوا, our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is trying to gain the attention of the sahaba radiallahu anhu majma'een. So he says, وَعْلَمُوا, that become aware, أنه لن ينجو أحد منكم بعمله, that none of you can attain freedom through your own actions. فقالوا ولا أنت يا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. So the Sahaba رضي الله عنهم أجمعين said, O Nabi of Allah, even you, can you not attain Jannah through your own actions? Nabi of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, ولا أنا إلا أن يتغمدني الله برحمة منه وفضل, أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. That not even me, Nabi of Allah is saying that even me, I cannot gain Jannah through my own actions, but only when Allah enshrouds and covers me with His mercy, with His grace, with His fadl, with His karam, then I will be granted entry into Jannah by the great being of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ya sallallahu alayhi wa sallam farma rahe hain, aur ek hadith mein aap sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ne صحابہ کو فرمایا کہ وَعْلَمُوا, جان لو اس بات کو اچھی طرح سے اپنے ذہنوں میں بٹھا لو, اَنَّهُ لَن يَنْجُوَ مِنْكُمْ أَحَدٌ بِعَمَلِهِ, کہ تم میں سے کوئی ایک بھی خود اپنے اعمال سے نجات نہیں پا سکتا. تو صحابہ رضی اللہ تعالی عنہ مجمعین نے اس پر سوال کیا اور انہوں نے عرض کیا کہ اللہ کے رسول صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم کہ آپ بھی خود اپنے اعمال سے جنت حاصل نہیں کر سکتے. تو آپ صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم نے جواب میں فرمایا ولا انا, میں بھی خود اپنے اعمال سے جنت حاصل نہیں کر سکتا. الا ان يتغمدني اللہ برحمت منه وفضل, مگر جبکہ اللہ مجھے اپنی رحمت سے, اپنے فضل سے, اپنے کرم سے, جبکہ اللہ اپنی رحمت سے, اپنے فضل سے, اپنے کرم سے مجھے ڈھانپ لیں گے, اس وقت میں جنت میں داخل ہو سکوں گا اللہ سبحانہ وتعالی کی اجازت سے. So my dear brothers, my dear sisters, the main point of this bayan today and the main point of this speech today was the saying of Hazrat Maulana Ashraf Ali Thanvi Rahimahullah Ta'ala. And in reality, this saying is the sayings of the Quran and the Hadith. And I will repeat that saying and I will conclude with that saying. تَأْخِيرِ طَاعَةٍ مَطْلُوب نَهِي تَسَارُعْ اور تَسَابُقْ إِلَى الْخَيْرَاتِ مَطْلُوب هِي. That to delay one's action is not recommended, encouraged by Sharia. But rather, as soon as the thought of doing a good deed comes in our minds and hearts, then Sharia encourages us to hasten in doing that good deed. We make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from now allows us to hasten towards good deeds. So when the month of Ramadan comes, we are already punctual with these good deeds and we can derive maximum benefit from the month of Ramadan. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi, subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik, أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك.